that comes from that. It comes from knowing that you've shared who Christ is within you to someone else. And that seed that is planted that someone else may come and water, it starts to become an increase. And last week, I had a few individuals stop me outside, and I was out greeting, and one of them, a young girl, and she says, "Pastor, please pray." She says, "Every day I deal with my addiction. Every day I want to get high. Please pray." And I had another young man. He'd come and he was shared with me what he was going through and talking about dealing with sin and this week and everything that's going on. We are here and we know God is faithful in our lives, but there just wasn't one memorial service this week. There was two memorial services. Another one of the young men that extended by part of this church, his name is Aaron Holmes. He passed away, ate up with cancer. Our young Adriana, memorial yesterday. We're filled with questions of why? Church, I don't have the answer. The only thing I have is the answer, and that's Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. He is those things that we lean upon. And I used it in a plural term for a purpose. No matter what you're going through, you come before Christ and he's the answer. He's one single individual that gave his life that we would have life and have it more abundantly. But he fits into every need that we have. He is the answer. As we did a devotion this morning in my home, my wife read about some people feeling that they are punished when in reality they're being pruned. Punishment and pruning seems to be the same thing. You go through the same kind of pain. You go through that same kind of mentality that something's being taken away or you've been in a place and God's wrath is falling on you. Sometimes what God is doing is preparing you for a greater thing within yourselves. And that's the reason why God laid upon my heart today to speak to you about dealing with sin. As the picture comes on the screens in front of you, I'm thankful for the ability to Google images. My wife this week did not have time to do the graphics that she normally does. But you read the word sin. I picked this particular image for what it represented within my own life to be able to bring to you an understanding. How many of you noticed that the eye in the middle is red? Because you can say it with me, I need to be covered with the blood of Christ. I, in the midst of my sin, I must be covered with the blood of Christ, because without the shedding of the blood, there is no remission of sin. You also notice that it's a different font. Once we become as Christ, we change. I want that to sink in just a little bit. The letter I in the middle of sin there is covered by the blood and it becomes a different individual. So you have been called out of the world. And if you are here this morning, and no matter what you're suffering through when it comes to sin in your life, what we know is that God himself provided the sacrifice through his son Jesus Christ that we can be forgiven of our sins. Back several weeks ago, I talked about God's grace. See, grace is those times that we are fallen before him. We fall in our relationship. We fall into some of the situations of temptations and we become weak and we sin within our lives. But I made a statement. I don't know if God's grace is always there if we choose to jump. Think about it for just a moment. It's one thing to stumble and fall. It's another to prepare to jump. Two different mindsets, two different actions, two different things of the heart. You fall, not on purpose, you fall on accident. You jump with a purpose. It's about the choices that we have in our lives and the choices that we make every day. Turn your Bibles with me into the book of Genesis, chapter 4. It's going to come up on the screens in front of you, and you can read along with me, not out loud, but read along with me. Genesis chapter 4. Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain and said, I have acquired a man from the Lord. Then she bore again, this time his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat, and the Lord respected Abel and his offering. But he did not respect Cain and his offering, and Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell. You skipped one. So the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry and why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door. Sin lies at the door. And its desire is for you. But you should rule over it. The enemy is out seeking whom he may devour. We're saved by the grace of God. We stand, we sit in the walls of a church all over this nation, all around the world. And men and women come before God to worship Him, to glorify Him, to have the Word of God brought to them and an application of the Word be applied to their life. We go through temptations, but in every temptation, God has provided through His Word an opportunity for us to literally flee from it. You as believers sitting here today, if you do not know the Lord, I pray that this challenges you in a way that you know before you leave this building that you have to accept Him. But if you've accepted Him as Lord and Savior, you're still not out of the woods. Every day we fight something. Well, Pastor, I'm doing pretty good. Well, you might be doing pretty good today, but it's not Monday yet. And you haven't walked in and dealt with the same boss that you've dealt with for the last several years of your life. And instead of praying for him and loving for him, you hate him. You hope that his wheels falls off of his car on the way home that night. I am so thankful that sweatshirts and longer pants, not necessarily long pants, but longer pants, are starting to show up. You can't drive down the street in the middle of summer without having to make sure that you are looking at the dotted line going down the road, because if you let your eyes wander, you can fall into temptation. You think somebody else is doing better than you. That's what happened in that passage of scripture I just read to you. How did you accept my younger brother's offering and you didn't accept mine? He became angry. It happens all the time. The enemy is out trying to put into your mind, into your path, into your life, those potholes that become a destruction to you. It becomes a detriment to you. You fall prey into those situations. When we look at the Word of God, we find that it gives us truly an understanding of the path that we must walk. Here, God gives a direct order. If you don't choose well, if you don't do well, if you don't make the right choice, sin lies at your door and you're going to be found guilty. You have to realize as you're going through life that it's up to you. The person sitting between your two elbows, the one taking up space in that pew right now, it's up to you. It's up to who I am to make right choices every single day. And guess what? If we mess up, the stupidest thing you can do is go and hide. To find isolation. Because God our Father wants you to run back to Him with arms up, crying out, "Oh, Dad, I messed up. Dad, I need you." But the world and the enemy wants to isolate you to where you're trying to do everything on your own. And guess what? Sweetheart, you're going to lose every time. Because you can't do it on your own. You can't find yourself trying to be saved in the middle of the ocean from drowning if there is no one there to help. You have to find the purpose within the Word of God for your life and apply it to your life. You have to find yourself becoming. You have to find yourself submitting to who God is. See, many of us have Bible knowledge. Individuals that can quote the Bible but yet do not serve God, there's one single fault. They have not submitted to who God is, His Lordship. See, we have to submit to who God is. We have to find ourselves saying, "Jesus, I have sinned. I need you in my life for the redemption of what I have done." See, the greatest example of having great knowledge of the Word of God and falling from the grace of God and not finding submission within who God is in their life is Satan himself. Think about that for a moment. He lived with the Word of God. He used the Word of God against Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ said, no, you're taking a few things out of context. Let me put it back into the right way. And he defeated him with the Word. See, all because you have Bible knowledge without application on your life does not mean that you're going to stay in the grace of God. It's when we submit to Him. Now, I know in some cases that word being submissive is misunderstood and exceptionally wrong word, especially misused. Being submissive means that you come in underneath the authority. Being submissive, when we look at it, is coming in underneath the hand. And for some of you as women, you've hated that passage of Scripture that we are supposed to be submissive to our husbands. Let me give you the understanding. Being submissive means that you come in underneath the hand of your husband. We're submissive, we come in underneath the hand of God. And the hand of God or the hand of the husband is there to protect you. Men, if we would quit leading our wives into the ditches of life, they would follow us a little more easier. Some men have taken the hand of authority and used it on their cheeks. Oh, I'll explain that. Instead of being the hand of love and guidance and encouragement, it became the hand of wrath. We've created some of our own problems from the beginning of time. The fall of man, sin came in. But when we find ourselves being submissive to God and we come underneath the hand of God and when God puts His hand upon us, it's not to destroy us. It's not to be placed upon us in His anger, but the hand of God. Leslie, come here. Just stand right here. You'll look extra small in front of me like that. The hand of God comes in. We find ourselves submissive to Him. We hear the word of God spoken into our lives, and we know that there's some days in our lives that we're going the wrong direction. So the hand of God comes in, and he just gently turns us to put us on a new path. Some days he just reaches out with his hand. You know, all of us parents have had kids in the front seat, and we had to stop real fast. We just throw the hand out there. There's sometimes God just comes in. Not necessarily even touching us, but saying, whoa, hang on a minute. See, the Word of God speaks to us, and the hand of God performs what the Word of God has already implanted within us. And we find that as we find ourselves submissive, God can turn us. God can direct us. God can stop us. God can just simply hold us. But dealing with sin, thank you. Dealing with sin is every day. You don't have to fall into temptation. You have to learn to get through it. You have to start purposing within your mind and your spirit. And I've shared this before. But back at one church that I had pastored, a man came to me. He says, Pastor, I'll never be like you. I don't know why he wanted to be like me. My goal is for you to become more like Christ, not to become like me. We were there. We went to a place, and my lovely wife here, she doesn't buy much, but she loves to shop. And we had to go do something, and we walked into Kohl's, and it was down in northern Illinois where we were pastoring. She went her way, and I went my way, and if you haven't noticed, I'm a pretty large guy, and not every place sells extra large clothes. So I go to the places that I do know something fits, like the shoes, socks, and ties. That's about the only thing that fits me in some of the stores. But I walked in, and I was looking at some stuff, and out of the corner of my eye, it's midsummer, and two hard-body young girls come in with not much more than what a ball cap could cover. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw. So I turned my back to it. And as they walked by, I kept my back to it. And that's what he was referring to. He says, you didn't see me, but I watched you. Now, it's not about me that I'm talking about. I'm talking about purposing in your heart to start dealing with sin. Set up a barricade. Set up a standard in your life. He says, I'll never be like you because instead of turning my back, I would have positioned myself to where I could have looked a little longer. Why fall into the sin? Because the Word of God says, if you think it in your heart, you've already committed the sin. That's one example within our lives that I can give to you because I experienced when a man came to me and says, I can't be like you. The fact is, he couldn't be like Christ. When we start learning to deal with sin, we start understanding that it is our purpose. It is our choice that keeps us from the depths that sin wants to take us. The addictions. The alcoholics. You didn't become an alcoholic overnight. You become an alcoholic because every day you chose to take a drink. It started with the first drink. Well, that can't harm me. I'm in control. I know what I was. I could suck the bottom out of a bottle. And I wasn't a beer drinker. I was a hard liquor drinker. And there would be days in my life that I'd make $1,000 that day. I'd spend $1,050 that night at a bar. There was days that I would wake up and I don't know where I was going, much less where I'd been. The individual that struggles with the addiction of good Lord, the many variety of drugs that have its hold on so many. It started with the first decision of smoking the first joint. Started with the decision of dropping the first pill. It was a choice that was made. Now, in the situation that they have got into, it's moved from a choice now to a necessity because the body depends upon it. Now we call it a disease because it actually became a disease within their body. And now they can't fight it without other drugs to help them fight it. But church, can I tell you one of the greatest things that will ever happen is to fall on your face before God and pray for deliverance. Because my God is faithful to deliver. You know how I know? I was delivered. There are certain places that we will not go in town. Because we're from the South, if you couldn't tell for our guest. Not every place that served fried chicken served booze. We come to Wisconsin, and every bar in town is a restaurant. I can't go into certain restaurants because of the whiskey and the booze that has saturated the bars. You know why? You smell it. And temptation and thoughts of those old days show up. How dumb is it to put you into a place that you have to fight it the entire time? Well, Pastor, you're saying you fight that? Not no more. Don't go in those places. Eliminate. Deal with the sin head on as God desires you to deal with it. I can't save you. I can only introduce you to the one that can save you. I can encourage you. I can be an influence to you. I can be an example to you. But it's up to you to get the job done. Thank you for the few amens that got. We want to see an increase in the harvest for the kingdom of God. But there's some days we're so busy trying to drag ourselves back up out of sin that we have no ability to pour into someone else that needs the same life preserver thrown to them. Do you realize that sin desires to have you? That's what the scripture said that I read to you. That sin desires to have you. In Luke 22 and 31. It says, and the Lord said, Simon, Simon, indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. James 1, 14 and 15. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then when the desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings death. I don't know too many instances that somebody's head was shoved to a table and snorted a line of cocaine. I don't know too many instances that somebody held you down, put a joint in your mouth, and made you inhale. I don't know too many times that I've heard of someone being held to a position in a bottle of whiskey put to their lips. Not too many times. Now, we know that's happened, but not too many times. Most of you in here, if you're struggling with things, and I look around, and as we had testimonies and we've shared, we got drug dealers that are now saved. We got alcoholics that was now prayed through. Did it take an instant for them to change? No. For one alcoholic that was a part, he was on the platform this morning. 18 years of praying before he ever got saved. And now he stands before you, an elder of this church, a leader of worship. one that will pray and seek after you when you are sick and in the hospital. Why? Because God saved him for a purpose. And some of you, you just want to exhale. And you want to say, God, what is my purpose? Our purpose is to be a witness unto Christ. Now, everybody, just take another deep breath. In through the nose, out through the mouth. For some of you, the need for you to be the greatest example is the person that you look at in the mirror. Don't back up with a truckload of excuses on why you can't. And start looking at the promises that you can. Every promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, every line. Every promise that is in the Word of God is applied to each and every one of us. We just have to accept it, receive it, and walk in it. We don't have to continue to do the same thing that we've always done. The definition of insanity. Doing the same thing, expecting a different result. That's just insanity. We have to make wise choices. We have to apply the Word of God into our life. When we deal with sin, we have to deal with it head on. Let me read something to you. I know I got it. Forgive me. It's entitled A Walk Down the Street. How many of you know you're still writing the chapters of the book of life that you're living? Every day you take up the pen and you write into it. You make choices of decisions every day. I found this rather comical, humorous, and very truthful. Chapter 1. I walk down the street. There's a deep hole. I fall in. I am hopeless and lost. And it takes me forever to climb out. Chapter 2. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in the hole again. I can't believe I'm in the same place, and it takes me a long time to get out. Chapter 3. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend it's not there. My eyes are wide open. I can see it there, but yet I still fall in. It's now a habit. But now I've learned how to get out immediately. Chapter 4. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I now try to walk around it. Chapter 5. I walk down a different street. This may be hard for you to hear. You fall in the same hole because you just haven't had enough courage to cut some of your friends. Hold that for me. I dropped the cap and it's too far. I don't know why the ground's so far down. It's hard to get there. Some of you need to cut your friends because it's your friends that you are using as an excuse for do the dumb things in life. Some of you have been more influenced by outsiders than you've ever been influenced by the Word of God, and that has to change. You have to be courageous in serving God. It's not easy, but it sure is rewarding. And then when it becomes a part of who you are, that every day you're in the Word of God, not just studying to prepare for a sermon, but in your Word of God because you find life through the bread of life. that you find that the application of God's word gives you hope and that you can present it to someone else. You walk through knowing that God is using you and there's a purpose within you, that you share the gospel to someone. And the greatest way to share the gospel is through your voice, through your actions, and by them watching you be truthful in your relationship. Some of you need the courage to simply say, enough is enough. Some of you need to have the courage to run to someone that's been there, done that, has the t-shirt, the hat, and the backpack. How did you get through it? How did you overcome this? As believers, our first answer is, well, because of Jesus Christ. Yeah, but I got Christ in my life, but I'm still suffering through this. How did you get over it? That's why we talk about doing life together. We have groups that get together on Tuesday night. Band of brothers come in, they talk. You know what's been saddened to me? It's diminished. Still, people are hurting. But that group attendance has diminished. I can tell you why. Most of them are in jail. But guess what? When they come out of jail again, they need us. You need each other. Women, if you're struggling through things, every Thursday night, there's a group that meets every other Thursday about healing hearts. Women that are dealing with either spouses or children. It's addicted to drugs. We have a men's group, Men of Valor, that meet every Saturday morning, and they have a great breakfast and a Bible study. The Bible study is the key. I don't know why I threw breakfast at me, because I'm anticipating a burger at the picnic. You're awesome. Thank you, Rebecca. Wednesday nights, just another couple weeks, Bible study is going to take place. It's going to be a Bible study some of you may have been a part of, and the fact that we'll study the Word of God, but we'll talk and we'll converse back and forth. The young couples meet, and they come in and they talk about life. We have so many opportunities, even like today, that we get to go and we get to do life. And if you're struggling with something and you want an attentive ear, come sit down by me. Or come stand by me as I'm whooping somebody in bags. I'm going to lose every game now. I can see. We got to have each other. We need each other. We need to be Christ, the representation of who He is to one another. And there's some days, there are some of us that need God to reach down and jerk a knot in our tail. Who didn't understand what I just said? I'll explain it in Wisconsin stuff. Jerking a knot in our tail, Dan, is when God gets a hold of us and puts a whooping. And the Word of God states it, and I express it. God loves us. And according to the Word of God, any father that will not correct their children hates them. God loves us, and He wants us to be corrected. And correction isn't a wrath. Correction is an improvement in our lives. Put the sign, sin, back up. If you're here this day and the eye within who you are has never been covered with the blood, I encourage you come and to give your heart to the Lord. If there's not a change in your life to where You're not associated with the things around you, but you're associated with God. If you've never had that happen, I encourage you to come and give your heart to the Lord. Dealing with sin and dealing with all the situations and the circumstances, you do not have to go through it alone. That's the glory of it. That's the glory of knowing Christ as Lord and Savior. Amen. In the crow's nest, if you will find some worship music and just put into our system. Thank you for the thumbs up. In Psalms 119 and 9, it says, how can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. In the same chapter, the 11th verse says, your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. In John 17, 15, 16, and 17, it says, I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. Water you turned into wine. How do we deal with sin? It's not just simply trying to overcome it with sheer willpower, strictness that puts you into a place of misery, being a place of misery. When you find yourself submitted to God, becoming overwhelmed by God's love, things change. God has his hand upon us. I'm going to ask you to stand. If you will, there's nothing mystical or magical, but if you'll just close your eyes, just to find yourself a little bit isolated here, would you play through your mind where you were at? Is there room for improvement in your walk? Is there a necessity within your life that you need to give yourself to God? If that answer is yes, I encourage you to step out and come this way. That you just simply step out and come this way. In this house, we love each other. In this house, we show grace and mercy. In this house, we don't judge. In this house, we are God's hand extended.